Mal presentations and mal positions, even though not common, are often important causes for prolonged labor. If not detected timely, may result in maternal morbidity and fetal morbidity, and rarely even lead to death of the mother and fetus. Before going to the topic proper, we will just define the basic obstetric terms. Lie of a fetus means the relationship of the longitudinal axis of the uterine ovoid to the longitudinal axis of the fetus. The most common lie, longitudinal lie, where the two axes are parallel, but when it is perpendicular, it is called a transverse lie, or if the two axes are oblique in relation, we call it as a oblique lie. So longitudinal lie is the normal lie, whereas transverse lie and oblique lie are we say it is an abnormal lie. Presentation is defined as the part of the fetus which occupy the lower segment of the uterus. 90 to 95% of the cases, it is a cephalic presentation. In 3%, it may be a breech occupy the lower segment, and 1%, it may be other presentation. Anything other than a cephalic presentation is an abnormal presentation. Presenting part we means that part of the presentation which is lying lowermost and the first to engage, which can be felt per vagina. So in the cephalic presentation, depending upon the attitude, we can have the vertus when the head is well flexed. If the head is extended, we get the face, and if it is on a deflexed head, we get a brow presentation. Of this, only the vertex is a normal presentation, whereas brow and face is an abnormal presentation. Coming to the position. Position is defined as a relationship of the denominator with the four quadrants of the pelvis. In a vertex presentation, occiput is the denominator, and the normal position for an occiput is left occipito anterior, or it can be a right occipito anterior. If the occiput occupies the posterior quadrant of the pelvis, it we call it as a posterior position. It may be either right or left, the right occipito posterior being more common. Sometimes we can even have an intermediate position between the anterior and posterior, we call as the transverse position. So you get a right occipito transverse and the left occipito transverse. By just being in the posterior quadrant, that is either ROP or LOP, just because of the position, it can cause labor problems. Hence it is called a mal position. Even though it is a vertex presenting part, just because of the position of the occiput will create problem. That is why it is called a mal position. Today we will be dealing with mal presentations, mal positions, and abnormal lie, excluding breech. Breech will be dealt separately. When the occiput occupies the posterior quadrants of the pelvis, we call it as an occipito posterior position and is considered as a mal position. Because of the distal rotation of the uterus and the position of the sigmoid colon on the left, right occipito posterior is more common than the left occipital posterior position. When the occiput is posterior, three positions are possible. One, where the occiput lies directly pointing to the sacrum, called direct occipital posterior, or it can occupy overlay the sacroiliac joint. If it is on the right side, we say it is a right occipital posterior, and when it occupies the left or overlays the left sacroiliac joint, we call it as a left occipital posterior. So it can be, there can be three positions. One is direct occipital posterior, other is right occipital posterior, and the left occipital posterior. And the problems with the occipital posterior positions are, there will be delay in engagement. This is because the convexity of the fetal ovoid or fetal back overlies the convexity of the maternal spine, which will result in deflection of the head, increasing the engaging diameter of the head from that of a suboccipital brachmatic to occipital frontal or suboccipital frontal. This will also result in prolonged labor, prolonged second stage, and there is more chance for instrumental delivery and cesarean rate. When there is more instrumental delivery and cesarean rate, injury to the mother and fetus also will be more. When there is cephalopelvic disproportion, the broader biparietal diameter goes posteriorly, or the occiput takes the posterior position, which is more comfortable to the fetus. Again, in abnormal pelvis, and the pelvis is anthropoid, the anteroposterior diameter is more than the transverse diameter, and often the pelvis is a high assimilation pelvis, and the occiput occupies direct posterior or a direct anterior position. In android pelvis, the forepelvis is more narrow, or this will lead the broader occiput to deviate to posterior and occupy the sacrocotyloid diameter. When the placenta is implanted on the anterior part of the body of the uterus, it pushes the head backwards, forcing to occupy the posterior position. In a normal pregnancy, the back is on the left side in 70% of the cases. In this case, the possibility of back being posterior is remote due to the presence of sigmoid colon and the distal rotation of the uterus. But in 30% of the cases, the back will be on the right side. Then always think of the possibility of a right occipital posterior. Come to the abdominal examination. On inspection, there can be subumbilical flattening due to lack of the curved back on the anterior. The back will be felt in the flank, and it may be difficult to palpate. Also, the fetal heart sound may be difficult to locate. The limbs will be felt anteriorly, and the fetal movements can be easily seen. And the most common cause for a mobile head at term, especially in a primary, is occipital posterior position. In labor, on my general examination. The posterior fontanelle will be occupying the posterior quadrant of the pelvis, and the sagittal suture will be in the oblique diameter. Anterior fontanelle will be easily palpable and will be in the anterior quadrant. If the posterior fontanelle is felt in the right posterior quadrant, it's the right occipital posterior, and it will be felt in the left posterior quadrant if it is a left occipital posterior. In latent labor, there can be large caput, and hence the identification of the fontanelle may be difficult. Hence, the direction of the pinna will help you. It will be pointing towards the occiput. Premature rupture of membrane, and the tendency to premature straining due to the occiput pressing on the rectum and early gaping of the introitus are features of occipital posterior position. The cardinal moments in mechanism of labor are engagement, descent, flexion, internal rotation, extension, restitution, and external rotation. Coming to the mechanism of labor in occipital posterior, since the back of the fetus is posterior, the convexity of the spine of the fetus will be overlying the convexity of the maternal spine, which may result in extension of the fetal head. So instead of the suboccipital bragmatic diameter in a vertus presentation, it will be a deflex head, and the engaging diameter will be either suboccipital frontal or occipital frontal, which is about varying from 10.5 to 11.5 centimeter. Due to this large engaging diameter, there will be delay in engagement of the fetal head. In labor, when the uterine contraction begins, the contractions will result in further flexion of the head and gradual descent of the head occur in occipital posterior position. So this will lead to prolonged labor, delay in engagement, and prolonged labor. After engagement, descent, and flexion, when the head reaches the pelvic floor, the next movement is internal rotation, which is the most important movement in labor. Here, the occiput rotates 45 degree anteriorly to come to lie under the symphysis pubis. This is the most important movement because at the brim, the anteroposterior diameter is less than the transverse and the oblique diameter. So the head engages, it is sagittal diameter in the oblique or transverse diameter, and it descends and reaches the pelvic cavity. At the level of the ischial spine, the anteroposterior diameter is almost equal to the transverse diameter, and this is the least pelvic dimension. And from there downwards towards the pelvic inlet, the anteroposterior diameter becomes more than the transverse diameter. So unless the fetal sagittal diameter comes in the anteroposterior direction, further progress of labor may come to a standstill. That is why internal rotation is important. So in internal rotation, the occiput rotates under the symphysis pubis, and it rotates about 45 degree in an anterior position. Thereby, the sagittal suture comes in the anteroposterior direction and further progress of labor occur. In occipital posterior position, it has to travel from the posterior quadrant all the way anteriorly, that is about, has to rotate about 135 degree. So depending upon the degree of flexion, if it is a well-flexed head, the occiput will be touching the pelvic floor first. Then the occiput will slowly rotate anteriorly, and majority of the cases deliver as occipito anterior and have a normal delivery. Only that it will take some more time to rotate. It may result in a prolonged second stage. In a small percentage, due to deflation, the sinciput may be at a lower level. Hence, when it touches the pelvic floor, the sinciput will rotate anteriorly and the occiput will have a reverse rotation to the whole of the sacrum. And the delivery will take place face to pubis, that is the root of the neck will be coming under the symphysis pubis, and there will be extreme flexion, and there will be delivery of the sinciput, brachma, then the occiput, then by extreme extension the rest of the nose face will be delivery. Here the occiput will be posterior, where the biparietal diameter will be distending the perineum. In normal cases, it is a smaller bitemporal diameter. So, there is more possibility of perineal damage in an occipito face to pubis delivery. In a minority of the cases, especially when it is an android pelvis, the rotation may totally fail to occur and it may persist in the same position. Then we call it as a persistent occipital posterior position. Or it may rotate slightly anteriorly and come to the situs suture will come to lie in the transverse diameter of the pelvis, and further progress does not occur, or further descent of the head does not occur. This is called deep transverse arrest. So, in occipito posterior position, the possibilities are can undergo a long anterior rotation and have a normal delivery. A few percentage can rotate posteriorly and deliver as face to pubis delivery. A small percentage may fail to rotate and persist as such. And another a small percentage have a small anterior rotation and come to a down arrest. We call the deep transverse arrest. In occipito posterior position, since we expect a prolonged labor, the patient should be counseled regarding this, and she should be given sufficient fluid to prevent dehydration, should be given sufficient analgesia. Epidural analgesia is the best. If it is not possible, IV sedation or endonox can be supplemented. Then a pathogram should be charted to know the progress of labor. And during, there can be premature rupture of membrane. And once membrane rupture, a vaginal examination should be done to exclude a cord prolapse. Sufficient time should be given in the second stage for rotation of the head. If it is a face to pubis delivery, you should expect perineal laceration, and you should give a prevent perineal laceration by giving a prophylactic episiotomy. Rarely, if even after full dilatation of the cervix and waiting for 1 hour in a multi or 2 hours in a primi, and in the presence of epidural analgesia, we can wait up to 3 hours. If still there is no progress and the occiput is in the same position, we call it as a persistent occipito posterior position. Or if the is a head remaining in the transverse position, we call it as a deep transverse arrest. So Diagnosis of persistent osteoposterior of deep transverse arrest is only after full dilatation and the specified time period, that is, the occiput remaining in the posterior position in spite of full cervical dilatation and waiting for 1 hour in a multi, 2 hours in a primary, and in the presence of epidural anesthesia waiting for 3 hours. We call it as a persistent osteoposterior. In deep transverse arrest also, the same criteria fulfills. The head should be in the transverse, the sagittal suture of the head should be in the transverse diameter in the mid pelvis. After full dilatation, remaining in the same position for 1 hour in a multi, 2 hours in a primary, and in the case of epidural analgesia, 3 hours. Still there is no progress and the head remains in the deep transverse, in the transverse axis of the pelvis, usually at the level of the spine. We call it as a deep transverse arrest. Coming to the management of persistent osteoposterior of deep transverse arrest, that depends on the station of the head at which the arrest occurs and the character of the pelvis. If the arrest occurs at zero or a higher position, better to go for a cesarean section. The failure of rotation may be due to abnormality of the pelvis. It may be due to loss of tone of the pelvic floor muscle, or it may be due to lack of uterine contraction. So especially in the primary, where the pelvis is not tested previously, and at higher position, we go for a LSAS. In a multi-para, where the pelvis is presumed to be normal, it may be due to lack of tone of the muscle or maybe lack of uterine contraction, which may be diagnosed from the pathogram. You can supplement with the oxytocin and may go for an instrumental delivery provided the head is well below, that is plus 2 or below, and the methods for delivery are, you can manually rotate the occiput to anterior, for that you may need an anesthesia, or if it is well lower down, you can use a digital rotation to rotate the head anteriorly and deliver. Or we can use vacuum extraction, where the by applying vacuum at the flexion point, the head will rotate automatically and deliver. Or if you are experienced, you can apply special forces like Keelan forces to rotate the head anteriorly and deliver. So the options are depending upon the station of the head and the rest of the pelvis. If the pelvis is suspicious or if the head is at a higher level, we go for a LSAS. If sufficiently low and the pelvis is normal, we can go for a manual rotation or vacuum extraction or use forces for rotation and deliver. In cephalic presentation, if the head is extended due to some reason, the presenting part will be face. By face we mean from glabella to the chin. And the denominator is the mandum. Submendobrachmatic, about 9.5 cm is the engaging diameter. There are different positions, like in a vertebral presentation, different positions are the about 70% will present as a mendo anterior and 30% will present as mendo posterior. The reasons for face presentation may be either maternal or fetal. Maternal factors which contribute to face presentation are contracted pelvis, obliquity of the uterus, multiparity and pendulous abdomen. The fetal factors which favor face presentation are anencephaly and enencephaly, cord round the neck, any tumors of neck like cystic hygroma or goiter, spasm of the sternomastoid muscle and a dolichocephaly head. Diagnosis of face presentation in the antenatal period is rare, and even if diagnosed, doesn't have any significance because when the labor sets in, the head may get flushed. In the perabdominal examination, you can get the cephalic prominence on the side of the back, and in second pelvic rib, the sinciput will be at a lower level than the occiput. In a vaginal examination, you get the soft tissue where it should be differentiated from the brow. In brow presentation, you will not get the chin. So if the chin is felt and the other the part, the glabella, root of the nose, the mouth and the chin is felt during my general examination. In brow presentation also, you may get up to the nose. So only if the chin is palpated well, we call it as a face presentation, and the mendum is the denominator. And the face presentation also has to be differentiated from a breech presentation. Here, the face presentation, the mouth and malar eminence form a triangle, and you can feel the hard alveolar margin between the mouth. And if the membrane is ruptured, you can put your finger into the mouth of the fetus where you will get a sucking action. And when you take out the finger, there will not be any meconium staining. Whereas in a breech presentation, the two ischial tuberosity and the anus are in a form a line. And in the absence of membrane, the anal orifice will grip on the finger due to the action of the anal sphincter, and the finger if down will be having meconium staining. The key parameters in the mechanism of labor in face presentation are: denominator is the mendum or chin, the attitude is complete extension, position possible are left and right mendo anterior, which are common, and less commonly right and left mendo posterior. The engaging diameter is a submendo bragmatic about 9.5 cm, and the diameter of engagement in the pelvis is one of the oblique diameter, right or left oblique diameter of the pelvis. From the chin to the biparietal diameter, the distance is about 7 cm. So, when the head is engaging, even after the chin is well advanced in the pelvis, maybe below the ischial spine and maybe even crowning, still the head may be palpable per abdomen. And so the vaginal examination, it may not be as reliable as in a Vattes presentation. In a Vattes presentation, from the vertex to the bipyrate diameter is only 4 cm. So when the head is engaged, no part of the head or only the sinciput will be palpable per abdomen, and the lower part of the vertex will be at the zero station. After engagement with the uterine contraction, there is the descent with the increasing extension. And when the chin or mandum touches the pelvic floor, the chin gets rotated anteriorly to come under the symphysis pubis. This is called internal rotation. And the chin gets under the symphysis pubis and acts as a pivot. And the head is borne by a movement of flexion, where the mouth, the nose, the forehead, the brachma, vertex, and lastly the occiput delivers. After the delivery of the head, there is restitution, which is corresponding to the untwisting of the neck, and external rotation, which is corresponding to the internal rotation of the shoulder, the same as in a vertex presentation. In mendo posterior position, 2/3 of the cases will rotate anteriorly and deliver as mendo anterior position, while 30% may remain in the posterior position or may rotate reversely to lie over the sacrum. Mendo posterior position cannot deliver as such, like in a occipito posterior position, because the short neck cannot negotiate the long posterior sacrum, and while descending, the chest will also be forced down into the pelvis, causing obstructed labor. So mendo posterior, if persisting in labor, is an indication for emergency LSCS. Coming to the management of face presentation, we have today estimation of the fetal weight, either by clinical estimation or by ultrasound, because any disproportion is an indication for CS. Here, unlike in a vertex presentation, there can be no molding of the fetal head, hence a trilo labor is not possible. Also, a thorough pelvic examination is done before allowing for a vaginal delivery, if any pelvic abnormality is again an indication for cesarean section. If it is an average sized baby and the pelvis is normal, we can allow vaginal delivery. Monitor the uterine contraction, fetal heart rate, descent of the presenting part, and cervical dilatation in a partogram. And if it is a mendo anterior position, usually normal vaginal delivery can be expected, and you can assist delivery by forceps if the face come down sufficiently lower in the pelvis, whereas a vacuum is contraindicated in face presentation. If the mendum is posterior, if given time, it may rotate anteriorly in 70% of the cases and deliver as mendo anterior and have a normal vaginal delivery. But unlike in a occipito posterior position, on a posterior rotation and face to pubis delivery is not possible, because when the chin is posterior and descending, while descending posteriorly, the chest will also be forced down and will lead to obstructed labor. So mendo posterior persisting even after full dilatation is an indication for cesarean section. So remember, in phase presentation, the indication for caesarean section are disproportion, abnormal pelvis, and persistent mendo posterior. Complication that can occur in a phase presentation are, since the presenting part is irregular, there is a small chance of premature rupture of membrane and corporal loss, more chance of instrumental delivery and operative delivery, leading to more injury to the mother, maternal morbidity will be there. Coming to the fetus, there can be laryngeal and facial edema. The eyes may be even damaged if you are not careful during vaginal examination, and it is wise not to use any cream during vaginal examination. Fetal injury, more chance of cephal hematoma. And if it goes into obstructed labor, there's a chance of fetal morbidity and mortality. Bro presentation is rare, occurs 1 in 1,000 deliveries. It is a transitory position, and when the labor sets in due to uterine contraction, either the head becomes flushed to present as to transform it into a vertex presentation, or it get more extended to form a phase presentation. It is often a cause for prolonged labor. The denominator is the forehead or the fondum, and the engaging diameter is vertebromandel, about 13.5 cm, which is the largest diameter of on the fetal head, and there is no normal mechanism of labor for vaginal delivery, and often resulting obstructed labor, and if undiagnosed, may lead to ruptured uterus, ending in maternal and fetal morbidity and mortality. Coming to the diagnosis, per abdomen, it may, there is a cephalic presentation, but you on the second pelvic rib, you get the occiput and sinciput at the same level or sinciput at a higher level, and it is confirmed or often diagnosed by a vaginal examination, where you get from the anterior fontanelle leg up to the glabella, or you can even get up to the nose. It is differentiated from the face by the chin. If the chin is palpable, it is a face presentation, whereas if the chin is not palpable, it is taken as a brow presentation. Once diagnosed, if the patient is in early labor, we can wait and watch closely to see whether it is converting into a vertex presentation or a face presentation. If the brow presentation is persisting in active labor, that is an indication for caesarean section, because if ignored, may lead to obstructed labor and its attendant complication. Other complications that can occur in brow presentation are premature rupture of membrane and cord prolapse. Transverse line is an abnormal line where the longitudinal axis of the uterine ovoid and the fetal ovoids are at right angles, and the presenting part is a shoulder. The denominator is the acromion, and depending upon the position of the acromion, there are four positions where it may be: left acromio anterior, right acromio anterior, right acromio posterior, and left acromio posterior. But most often, for detecting the position, the position of the back is used. and according to the position of the back, the position can be dorso, anterior, where the back is facing anterior, anteriorly. The back may be posterior, then it is a dorso posterior position. The dorsum and the, or the back can be superior facing the fundus, or it may be inferior. What we call the dorso superior and dorso inferior. The position of the back is important because for delivery, even during cesarean session, unless you know the position, it may cause difficulty in delivery. The incidence is rare, it may be 1 in 500. The causes for transverse lie may be maternal factors like multiparity, contracted pelvis, anomalies of the uterus, placenta occupying the lower segment, or fibroid in the lower segment. Or it may be due to fetal factors like prematurity, multiple pregnancy, polyhydramnios, or death of the fetus. On inspection of the abdomen, it may be transversely distended. The height of the fundus may be less than the period of amenorrhea, and on examination, the fundus as well as the first pelvic rib may be empty, and the head and breech may be felt in either flanks. If the patient is in labor, you can do a vaginal examination and can see the gridiron pattern of the ribs, that is, there will be multiple parallel small bones, which is the ribs, may be palpable. This is called a gridiron pattern of ribs. In advanced labor, there may be premature rupture of membrane, often causing prolapse of the arm and cord prolapse. In the antenatal period, ultrasound may be helpful to diagnose the, confirm the presentation, and also it is important to locate the placenta, because often the cause of transverse lie may be placenta previa. There is no natural mechanism of delivery for a fetus presenting as transverse lie. This will lead to obstructed labor and ruptured uterus if allowed to labor. So, in a fetus who is average weight and with a normal pelvis, if allowed to labor, it will go to prolonged labor, its complication lead to obstructed labor, and finally culminate in ruptured uterus, leading to loss of the mother and baby. In rare situation where the baby is very much preterm or dead and the pelvis is very roomy, there is a mechanism what we call as a birth corpora quadruplicata, where the baby gets delivered by doubling up upon itself. Or due to uterine contraction, the head end may be pushed past the shoulder and delivered as a vitreous presentation, what we call as the spontaneous rectification. Or the opposite may happen, where the breech part may be pushed down due to uterine contraction and delivered as breech, which is called spontaneous evolution. Another rare but important complication that can occur in transverse lie is neglected shoulder presentation, where the transverse lie is undiagnosed and the woman is allowed to labor, which often takes place if the woman is going for a home delivery. It should not happen in modern obstetrics or in a labor room which is supervised. Here, due to when the labor is allowed to progress, there will be premature rupture of membrane, cord prolapse, and the arm will also prolapse. And it may lead to prolonged labor, and features of obstructed labor may develop, and fetus may be invariably dead. So remember, neglected shoulder presentation is a complication of transverse lie, where the fetus and the mother is in danger, and it should not occur in a modern labor room, and it is a may occur only when the woman is allowed to labor having a transverse lie and undiagnosed. The complication that can occur in transverse lie, there is increased chance of cesarean section. In undiagnosed cases, prolonged labor leading to obstructed labor and ruptured uterus, and more chance of puerperal sepsis. With regard to the fetus, there is small chance for birth asphyxia and stillbirth if undiagnosed. Coming to the management of transverse lie, the lie presentation and position, etc., become fixed only after 34 weeks. So, if the transverse lie is diagnosed before 34 weeks, there is no need to worry. You can observe her and wait up to 34 weeks. If it is persisting after 34 weeks, we can try a standard cephalic version. And this can be done after 34 weeks up to term, where we turn the fetus into cephalic presentation by external manipulation. Before doing version, you have to rule out any contraindication like placenta previa, any fetal anomaly, and you can also the amount of like by doing an ultrasound. If the version is successful, well and good, you can allow the pregnancy to continue. She may go for a spontaneous labor and have a successful vaginal delivery. If the version fails, we have to do an elective cesarean section at 38 weeks. And she should be admitted sufficiently early, that is about 37 weeks, to prevent her from getting into labor at home and having complications like premature rupture of membrane and clot prolapse. If the woman is happened to seen in labor, if she is in early labor with the intact membrane, we can still try for a external cephalic version, but the chances are the success may be less. So if it is not successful, you have to go for an emergency cesarean section. If the woman is seen in a late labor where already complications like arm prolapse, cord prolapse, and that is what we call as the neglected shoulder presentation, where the baby is dead, then you have the option of destructive operation, if provided the obstetrician is skilled and there is no features of obstructed labor. You can do under general anesthesia, you can cut the fetus in the neck into two and deliver the baby by the decapitated trunk first, followed by delivery of the decapitated head. If the obstetrician is not skilled, or if there is a features of rupture impending rupture uterus or obstructed labor, even if the baby is dead, you have to go for a emergency cesarean session to avoid complications like rupture uterus. So in nutshell, in the management of transverse lies, external cephalic version, if the patient is not in labor, if not successful, you have to go for an elective cesarean section. If seen in labor with the intact membranes, try version. If not successful, go for emergency cesarean section. And in neglected shoulder presentation, where the baby is dead and the obstetrician is skilled and no features of obstructed labor You can go for a decapitation surgery, or if there is features of obstructed labor, or the obstetrician is not skilled, even for a dead baby, go for a cesarean section. When one of the extremities present along with one of the fetal pole, it is known as compound presentation. A foot or lower limb presenting with the bridge is not included in the definition. There can be associated cord prolapse also. The incidence varies from 1 in 1000 to 1 in 200 deliveries. The combination of vertex and hand is the most common presentation. Etiology, the most common cause is prematurity, where the preterm head allows the limb or the foot to descend. Other causes are maternal age, multiparity, contracted pelvis, and external cephalic version. The different types of compound presentation are vertex and hand, vertex and foot, vertex along with both hands and foot, bridge and upper limb. And usually when the uterine contraction begins and the head descends, the limb will be pushed up. And if the limb is not pushed up, you can manually try to push up the limb. If it is not able to push up, the labor may not progress, and we may have to resort to a cesarean section. The complication that can occur in compound presentation are cord prolapse, fetal heart irregularity, and birth asphyxia. Diagnosis is usually made during labor, where we can feel the one of the limb or can be felt along with the head or along with the bridge. The indication for cesarean section are: if repeated vaginal examination reveals persistent compound presentation, cord prolapse occurs, or progress of labor does not occur, or if there is fetal heart rate abnormality. Umbilical cord presentation is one where the cord may be felt along the side of the presenting part or below the presenting part with the intact membranes. When the membrane rupture, the cord may prolapse and may present below the presenting part. It may prolapse into the vagina or even out of the introitus. Then it is called overt cord prolapse. If the cord is felt along the side of the presenting part and membrane is absent, we call it a occult cord prolapse. Cord presentation and cord prolapse are more common with the malpresentation. Of the malpresentation, transverse lie is the most common cause for cord prolapse, followed by flushed bridge, foot limb presentation, and compound presentation. Extended bridge and vertex presentation, since they fit into the lower segment very well, the chance of cord prolapse are less. Other causes are contracted pelvis, multiple pregnancy, when the lycor is more, if the cord is long, abnormal placenta like a battledore placenta, multiparity. And it may be also iatrogenic, as it occurs during an artificial rupture of membrane
or during version, both external cephalic version and internal podalic version.
Cord presentation cannot be diagnosed antenatally. Sometimes ultrasonography may show loops of cord below the presenting part. In such cases, if it is preterm, frequent ultrasonographic examination may be required. And if it persists, even after 38 weeks, an elective cesarean section is in order to prevent cord prolapse and its complications. Cord prolapse, on the other hand, can only be diagnosed after rupture of the membranes, where the cord may be seen lying outside the introitus or may be seen inside the vagina, and in occult cord prolapse may be felt by the side of the hair, presenting part sometimes. Once the cord gets prolapsed, the fetal mortality is very high. This is because the umbilical cord gets compressed between the presenting part and the bony pelvis, leading to hypoxia, asphyxia, and sudden fetal death. Even if the cord is not compressed by the presenting part, its exposure to the atmospheric air may cause spasm of the umbilical vessels and lead to fetal hypoxia, or even handling of the cord lying outside and trying to reposition in the vagina may again cause spasm of the umbilical vessels and asphyxia. So the fetal mortality is very high, in about 50 to 80%. Prevention of cord prolapse may not be possible always, but in certain situations you can prevent cord prolapse by looking carefully for cord presentation or early detection of the cord prolapse. In situations where there is malpresentation, preterm labor, polyhydramnios, high mobile head, you can carefully look for any presence of cord below the presenting part, and before avoid an artificial rupture of membrane. Or if it is a spontaneous rupture of membrane, immediate vaginal examination may reveal any cord prolapse and help in an early diagnosis. Always anticipate cord when you do an artificial rupture of membrane in a high mobile head, hydramnios. So in such cases, better to use a needle instead of a Cocker's, or you can resort to a high rupture of membrane instead of a low rupture membrane. Be careful while doing an amino infusion or insertion of a scalp electrode. Anticipate rupture of membranes and cord prolapse while you do procedures like external version and internal podiatric version. While in labor, sudden appearance of fetal bradycardia or persistent variable deceleration, always look for any cord prolapse. A vaginal examination is a must after rupture of membranes in the above anticipated conditions. So the management of cord presentation at term, where you feel the umbilical cord below the presenting part, is an indication for elective cesarean section. Otherwise, when the membrane rupture, cord prolapse will occur and it becomes an emergency. Once cord prolapse occur, the management depends upon the gestational age, whether the fetus is live or not, and the stage of labor. The immediate danger in cord prolapse is fetal hypoxia and death. So immediate delivery should be expedited in order to save the baby. If the fetus is viable and the cord is pulsatile, which indicates the fetus is alive, an immediate cesarean section should be done to save the baby. In rare instances where the cord prolapse occurs in the second stage and the head presenting part is sufficiently low, you can expect delivery immediately through the vagina by assisted vaginal delivery or instrumental delivery. A forceps is more useful in this situation. If the cord is not pulsatile, which means the fetus is dead, or if it is extremely preterm, where the viability of the salvageability of the baby is almost none, then there is no urgency. You can wait for vaginal delivery. Procedures like elevation of the foot end of the patient, use of tocolitis to prevent uterine contractions, and filling of the urinary bladder will help to prevent cord compression while you take the patient for cesarean section. So always remember, cord prolapse is an obstetric emergency, and if it is a viable live baby, immediate delivery will save the baby, and if there is any delay will result in fetal mortality. Always 50 to 80% fetal mortality is there in a cord prolapse. To conclude, malpresentations and malpositions are the common causes for prolonged labor. Malpresentations, if not detected timely, may lead to prolonged labor, obstructed labor, and even ruptured uterus. This may result in perinatal mortality and maternal morbidity. Timely detection and interference may save the mother and baby. Thank you for listening.